Well, let me say something about the famous two-slit experiment, which Richard Feynman says it's really the entire mystery of quantum mechanics is the two-slit experiment. So, well, before I say that, let me say something else again. Let's consider how was it that, what was the evidence that the founding fathers of quantum mechanics used to arrive at the idea of a wave function? All the evidence was in the form of photographs taken in a laboratory, or essentially is, they're sort of generalized photographs. All the evidence, John Bell says this, all the evidence for quantum mechanics is essentially in structures that we see in non-quantum terms. It could be computer printouts and things like that. This is very close to the Copenhagen interpretation that in the end, you have to describe the outcome, the setting up and the outcome of experiments in classical terms. So what they assumed, so very important was the discovery of tracks in cloud chambers. So a cloud chamber that Wilson had created, he put it in a metastable state, supersaturated, and suddenly he noticed these tracks. So this was the discovery of cosmic rays, these tracks, these curved tracks. If there was a magnetic field, the tracks would be curved. So essentially, what the founding fathers were doing were trying to explain the structure in photographs by saying, before the photograph is taken, there are particles moving in through space and time at the same time as a wave function was evolving and affecting the motion of those particles. They were very much under the influence of de Broglie's idea. And then a photograph is taken and captures the positions of the particles relative to each other. It doesn't show the wave function at all. It shows the particles. And then they essentially, really, the whole of quantum mechanics, I believe it's fair to say, was deduced from that sort of information. Now, there's a possibility that the same fact, the same information, evidence, could be explained in a completely different way. Suppose some deity outside the universe takes a photograph, a snapshot, when the has a just a, one particular when, and the snapshot is captures the universe with just one particular value of the complexity. That's one condition. It's a bit like an eigenvalue in the time-independent Schrödinger equation. And then there are probabilities for those shapes. There's lots of shapes with that complexity, and some of them are in regions that are much more probable than have a higher probability. And suppose you look carefully in all those shapes, you might find in one of them, just in a tiny part of it, exactly that photograph. And then the photograph would have a totally different explanation that does not in any sense rely upon a wave function or Planck's constant. It's just because it's a shape with a given value of the complexity. So that is a possible explanation. Now people just shake their heads when I say that. But now think about something also with the two slit experiments. So you could, one of those photographs could show the two slit setup. It could show the macroscopic source from which whatever these particles are that are being used in the two slit experiment. It could show the two slits, and it could show the emulsion on which the individual impacts are captured. And those could be, so to speak, Bayesian priors. That would be prior information. You could get that information, but you don't yet look at the emulsion. And then you could look at the emulsion and say, ah, there are these impact things there that look like interference fringes. So maybe it's just a case of correlation. I was saying earlier, there's all these correlations that geometry just puts there. So maybe if you put the priors that correspond to the setup of the two-slit experiment, lo and behold, you will get what the outcome is. And then if you actually, I've now started looking, checking out. So the first thing, a bit like a two-slit experiment with extremely low density, I think it's equivalent to a candle a mile away, where actually there can only have been individual photons coming through, was 1909 by G.I. Taylor. And then there was another, a more experiment made a few years before Dirac made his famous comment that each photon interferes with itself. But if you think about the setup for these things, already just reading the details of the Taylor experiment from 1909, it's incredibly special, very, very special setup that was used. So could it be that that incredibly special setup forces correlations to appear in the form of the two-slit, the interference patterns? But let me read another thing, which it reminded me. So maybe those patterns were created by the experimentalist. They're not something that just wandering around, looking around the universe, that you would easily see. And here's a lovely quotation from Eddington again, from, I think it's his 1922 book on general relativity. He says, "We have found a strange footprint on the shores of the unknown. We have devised profound theories, one after another, to account for the origins. At last, we have succeeded in reconstructing the creature that made the footprint. And lo, it is our own." So maybe the human experimentalists who set up an incredibly special situation were actually what created those interference fringes by doing that. It's not impossible.
I listen extremely carefully, and you used the word deity once, and earlier you used the word gift when speaking about experience and consciousness. I'm curious about your views on God.
I think about a bit over a year ago, I started reading books on consciousness, which has made me sort of think about these things a bit. I would say I'm agnostic. I do think, though, now that there is something incredibly amazing about the universe. It is all the sights and sounds and the colors and the things. I don't have it to hand, but there's a W.B. Yeats hated, like William Blake, hated Newton and science because Yeats said something along the lines, Newton took away everything, all the sights and sounds, and left us just the excrement of the world. But Bishop Berkeley, the idealist, so Bishop Berkeley said, there are only souls or minds, and God implants ideas in these lines. And an interesting thing is, I did actually get round to checking the etymology of idea.
Uh-huh.
Any idea what it is?
No, no idea.
It comes, it's the Greek word for a pattern, a shape. So going back to what Lucretius was saying, and the ancient atomists, they wanted to have a theory of shapes. So I think mathematics defines the shape, the shapes, starting with a triangle, but going up to any tetrahedron, any complicated shape you like. And then somehow or other, consciousness for us gives us the gift of seeing all these things, hearing, and so forth. Now, whether this makes me more inclined to believe in some sort of divinity, I don't know. I did now start checking out the etymology of divine. And this comes from Sanskrit. It's also related to sky. The island of sky in the northwest of Scotland and the sky we see, that's all tied in. I guess it's our idea of wonder, where we just look at the stars in the sky. And so I think it's Sanskrit word deva for a god, these sort of things there. But I mean, who am I to say? All I can say is it's pretty damn wonderful. That's all I will say with confidence.
Oh, yeah.
But I do like the idea that I'm getting more and more confident about this idea that mathematics just creates that structure. And there couldn't even just be points in space. I mean, particles gives you some idea that they're a bit like tiny billiard balls or something, but they might just be purely mathematical points. By the way, it's interesting that the Newtonian n-body problem, the word body there is just a historical leftover. So when Newton formulated the first law of motion, he said any body continues in a state of rest or uniform motion in a straight line unless it's acted on by force. But already but then explicitly the great mathematicians who followed him, Leonard Euler and Lagrange in the 18th century, when they were the real creators of the modern n-body problem, it is actually point particles. So what I like about point particles is that they have no size. So the only quantities that come in of the separations between the particles, and then you make it scale invariant by dividing by that root mean square length, the average. So, and then you get pure numbers. So really that's what the first great scientific dynamical theory is about. It's about just points. So I'm now coming, but I mean, I have to be honest, some of these ideas have only come to me in the last day or two, that you asked about the perihelion advance. Maybe we should look much more seriously at the role that the instruments that we use to make these observations are playing. Think about, I've already talked about the two-slit experiment. I mean, it's unbelievable, the tiniest little thing in the most special environment. But then think about radio telescopes or these incredible ones at 5,000 meters in the Atacama Desert in northern Chile. I mean, these are very, very special structures. Is it possible that we think that the experiments are just discovering what is out there, but it could be that to some extent they're creating they're playing a significant role in creating what is observed. I've already made this point with the two-slit experiment, that they're forcing. The two-slit experiment means that we will only look at a very, very special part of a shape. That's required. So maybe all these marvelous instruments, telescopes, all of them, electron microscopes, are playing a significant role in creating what is observed. And I come back to what Eddington said, you know, we have found a strange footprint, and lo, it is our own.
As you know, on Theories of Everything, we delve into some of the most reality-spiraling concepts, from theoretical physics and consciousness to AI and emerging technologies. To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of Toe, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.